Jesus, we lift up your name. 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 We lift up your name.
If you want wisdom for daily living, to win your wars, you've come to the right place, the Word of God, the teaching of the Word of God. Remember, God spoke to Joshua. He said, Joshua, if you want to win and have great success and be prosperous, he said, stay with the Word. Let not this Word depart out of your mouth. Don't let the Word get out of you. This is what we're doing, bringing the Word to you, bring success to you, and make sure you stay connected and let the friends know that the Word of God is being preached. Let's join in the Word.
Yeah. Father, I was grateful and thankful indeed for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for being so good to us. We thank you for Jesus as our high priest, our savior, deliverer. We thank you for what you continue to do for us. We thank you for the great mighty Holy Spirit, who is our teacher and our guide, who's guiding us into the things of God, continually anointing us. And I ask that, Father, as you minister to people, you would be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, welcome to Feed Day. Thank you, God, for another day for us of teaching, spending time upon the Word of God. I want to take a subject today from the Bible, from the book of 1 Peter, chapter 3, verse number 10. I want to tackle my sermon, Good Life. So you can tell from the sermon that I want to concern myself today about how life works, what is life. Many people, as one good friend of mine said, some people leave and never figure out what life is all about. Someone said they even come to the point of dying without knowing what life is all about. So when I take a scripture from the book of 1 Peter chapter 3, verse number 10, I'm going to read it in different translations so that we can bring out different nuances and different shades of meaning so that they can contribute to making a proper foundation and a bedrock for our teaching this morning. It says, 1 Peter 3, verse 12, NIV says, whoever would love life and see good days, days, plural, must keep their tongue from evil and their lips from deceitful speech. God wants us to enjoy life. So therefore, in the Bible, there is such a thing as enjoyment of life. Many people are of the view and opinion that sometimes by being Christian, by being God-loving, you're signing up for sour life, you know. People think like that. They think that there is nothing, you know, worth enjoying when you become a Christian. When you're in the Christendom, there's all kinds of problems and you're always praying, you're always crying. But no, the Bible says the one who wants to enjoy life, we do enjoy life. And see good days, we see good days. Not problematic days. Not ugly days. Not nasty days. Not just evil days, but good days, the Bible says. If you want to see good days, whether the Amplified says, good days, whether apparent or not, must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking guile. The CEV translation says, do you really love life? I like that. Do you really love life? Do you want to be happy? It says. Then stop saying cruel things and quit telling lies. Then stop saying cruel things and quit telling lies, it says. Another translation says, the good news says, as the scripture says, if you want to enjoy life and wish to see good times, not good days, good times, great times, when everything is going well, see good times, is linked to how you talk, the Bible says. If you want to enjoy life and see good times, you must keep from speaking evil and stop telling lies. The God's Word translation says, people who want to live a full life, I like that, want to live a full life, not an empty life, a full life, not half life, but a full life. And enjoy good days, the Bible says. If you want to live a full life, I want to live a full life. Life which is full of blessings, full of anointing. And life which is long, full life. The Bible says you must keep their tongues from saying evil things and their lips from speaking evil things. The Weymouth translation. I remember I bought the Weymouth translation when I was very much young in the things of God. It says, for he who wishes to be well satisfied. Can you see how it says it, approaches it? The Weymouth translation says, he who wishes to be well satisfied, satisfied with life, satisfied with some other people that can never get to the place where satisfied, the Bible says you can. And it says, you're willing to be well satisfied with life and see happy days. Let him restrain his tongue from evil and his lips from deceitful words. So the Bible says you have a responsibility to him. So today we're not just talking about an event and something that goes well. Maybe you're getting a bursary in school or you're getting a job or you're buying a car, you're buying a house. We're talking about the sum total of existence on earth. We call it a life, the life that you live. The Bible says if you want to live good life, if you want to enjoy good life, different translation says this, if you want to have a full life, if you want to see many happy days and see good times, the Bible says, of course, I want to believe all of us, and those who are watching television and online, you do want to see good life in your life, for your children, for your family. You don't trust to, you know, your life to be a slog, and all the time you're having to put out fires and life is too difficult and you regret it. And I would imagine that sometimes are some of the reasons why some people who don't know these truths and, you know, who are not in possession of truths like this sometimes take their lives because they feel life is too difficult. It's not worth living. I'd rather take my life. But no, you don't have to take your life. There's a way to have a good life. There's a way. I'm going to show you today. We're talking about a life. We're talking about life and how life works. So we have a life perspective, not just an event perspective. Now, what we find out from these verses we've just read, we can't talk about good life without teaching you how to use your tongue. That's a fundamental statement. Because it says you must refrain your tongue from speaking evil and speaking guile and other things that the Bible talks about. There's no other way. We can't bring you to a place where you enjoy life and see good days and good times without educating your tongue, without bringing you to a place and teaching how to use your tongue. Tongue management, okay, as I call it, is a clear teaching of Scripture from the Old Testament, tongue management, to manage your tongue. Tongue management, I know we're familiar with self-management, time management, but I'm talking about tongue, words management. Tongue management is a clear teaching of Scripture from the Old Testament. We can also see in the Decalogue, in the Ten Commandments, Exodus chapter 20, verse 16, it says, "You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor." God taught us there that, hey, watch out. You do not say bad things about your neighbor that are not true. The Bible is about encouraging us to start speaking our mouths well, because we are interested, we're invested in making sure our lives turn out good and our lives turn out well. David says in the book of Psalms chapter 19, verse number 14, "May the words of my mouth," you know. Now we're showing you how to, you know, to get on a journey to use your mouth right. Remember, we're talking about life. We recognize that based on the verse that we've read in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse number 10, that my words and my evil speaking and how I speak can have a negative effect upon my life, can trap my life, can stop my life, can prevent my life from being good, from being colorful, from being bright, decorated life, from having a great life, from having a full life, from having good days. And I don't want that. I don't want anything. I don't want bad days, because bad days, some other people never recover from bad days. Some other people, you know, they lose their health, their mental health over bad days. Other people, you know, mental health gets negatively affected over difficult times and bad lives, and the life that is bad in relationships and everywhere else in their lives. Okay, so David says in Psalm chapter 19, verse 14, "May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, my rock and my redeemer." That's what he says. That's what David says. He says in the NIV, "May the words of my mouth." So David is conscious of his words. He says, what about his words? David, what about your words? Then he tells us. He says, "May the words of my mouth be pleasing to you, my rock and my redeemer." David says, I'm making an effort to make sure my words are pleasing to God. So therefore, it lets us know that the first checking authority of his words are not the people he's speaking to, is God himself. Because it says, "May the words of my mouth be pleasing to you," which means God must be pleased with the words I speak to my wife, to my kids, to my enemies, to my friends, to the people I work with. God must be pleased with those words. If God is not pleased with the words, then we understand that we need to make sure that we check up our mouth and how do we speak. Then the same verse in the Brenton Septuagint translation says, "So shall the sayings of my mouth," the same verse, Psalms 19 verse 14. It says, "So shall the sayings of my mouth and the meditation of my mouth be continually pleasing before thee, O my helper and my redeemer." Continually pleasing. So therefore, not only we pass the test of just my words being pleasing to God when I speak to a boss or someone in authority, because peradventure, maybe if I speak bad to them, they will take my raise, they will take my performance bonus. It says the continual to everybody else. From the greatest to the smallest, from the unimportant to the important, from the VIPs, very important people in my life across the board, to the people that are neglected and are insignificant. It says, "May my words continually be pleasing to your God." So we have a responsibility to make sure that our words are not just careless words, are not destructive words, are pleasing words. So therefore, if my words are pleasing to God, then they achieve the same purpose that God would use his words for. And remember, the words of God are contained in Scripture. And in the Bible, God has spoken words that build our faith. God has spoken words that that motivate us, that take us out of unbelief and fear. Words of God in the Bible, they minister hope to us. We have trust and hope, and we trust in his character. So therefore, the words that I speak must be consistent and be in alignment with the same words of God. If God's word build faith, my words must build faith in the people. After people have interacted with me, come close to me, and have been in my orbit and in my space, and have spoken to me, had a meeting with me, by the time they leave, they depart, they say, "Oh my God, that guy
they've spoken so well. I feel my confidence has come back. So the Bible says our words must be pleasing to God. Psalms 141 verse 3 says in an NIV, set a guard over my mouth, Lord. Keep watch over the door of my lips. I like that. The NLT say, take control. I like the NLT. Take NLT says, the New Living Translation. Take control of what I say, O Lord. Guard my lips. And then when it says set a guard, kind of like set a security guard, if you don't mind, we put it like that. Put a security guard over my mouth. Let him do a words check. What would the guard is? He's guarding the words. He says, no. Let those words go back. Let those words go back. Those are not becoming words. Those are not words for the season, for this event and for your left. You can't be speaking words like that. So he put a guard over my mouth, kind of like this guard is guarding my words every time. And guess what? You can't continually have a guard over your mouth, be it the Holy Spirit and God himself and your conscience, or a consciousness of the fact that God is aware of what I'm saying, and never grow in speaking right. So David, we understand. That's why then David's life was a good life. He was a king. He was one of the most decorated kings. Not only his significance and his importance and his pedigree and his legacy was only confined to his time when he was alive. It goes right across into the New Testament. Jesus is called the Son of David. So David's life is extended into Christ, becomes the foundation of Christ's acceptance among the Jews, and they call him the Son of David. That's why Jesus could stand up in public and speak, because he was associated with the king based on his family lineage, was associated with the king called David. And why? Because David knows that if I keep my mouth right, I put a guard over my mouth, my life will come out on top. Remember, we're talking about life. Proverbs 18 verse 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. You see, death and life. We're talking about life. We're not talking just about an event. We're talking about your entire life. How it's going to turn out. I don't know about you. I want my life to turn out well. I want to have a good life. The Bible says if you want to enjoy life, if you want to have good life, want to have a good life, want to enjoy life. I don't just want to go to heaven. I'm not just be a believer just to go to heaven. I'm not heavenly minded and utterly useless. You say, I want to have enjoy life. I want to have a good life. I want to say I enjoyed God in church. I also enjoyed God in my life, because there's a place for enjoyment, enjoying God, enjoying a good life, having a good life, everything going well. And this morning we're talking about good life. And I want to make sure, because the Bible promises it. It's not something that's imaginary, that's outside of reach, that can't be reached. It's not something that's a fabrication of the preacher on the pulpit. It's not something that I'm speaking motivationally, bringing psychology to the pulpit. Nada. It's the Bible, sweetie. It's the Bible. It's the scripture that says if you want to enjoy a good life, if you want to have a good life, it's the scripture that promises me that. And who promises? None other than the biggest of the apostles, Peter himself, the first among equals. He tells us we can have that. Okay, so we need to respect our tongue as a life. Now, this is a line that we need to understand. We need to respect our tongue as a life-shaping device and instrument for destruction or life-building. Okay, so we need to respect our tongue as a life-shaping device or instrument for destruction or life-building. So you can build with good words and you can destroy your life with bad words. For it says death and life are in the power of the tongue. Matters of life, matters of good life, matters of increase of life are connected to your words, to your speaking. So if you pay attention, if you do the prayer, some of us need to start today to pray the prayers of David when he prayed. Now it will be a good time to drop in a biblical example, now that I've laid down the principles of how this works and have interacted with the prayers of people who are vested, who have an interest in having a good life, who want to make sure the words of their mouth are correct, who want to make sure what they say ministers grace to people, who want to make sure how what comes out of their mouth is what is necessary for admonition, for grace, for encouragement, for motivation, and helping other people. Now, let's look at the life of Zechariah in the book of Luke chapter 1. Now, to be exact, Zechariah is the father, becomes the father of John. John, he becomes a cousin of Jesus Christ based on the record of scripture, if you read the entire record of Luke chapter 1. And what happens is this, is that John is a priest. I beg your pardon. Zechariah, the father of John, is a priest. And he's busy executing his priestly functions. And he's busy evening sacrifice. And he's busy executing his priestly function an angel of the Lord, an angel of good message. Remember, we've got two archangels, Gabriel and Michael. The one is for war and one is for good news. Who happens to appear twice in the book of Luke chapter 1? He appears to Zechariah and appears to Mary, bringing good news about children. Well, as a matter of fact, both of these accounts is appearing to them about children. And so the angel of the Lord appears to Zechariah and says, good news. Your prayers have been heard. The angel says to John, your prayers have been heard. God has answered your prayer. But the Bible tells us, number one, before it gets there, it tells us about the fact that they respected God. They knew God and they loved God. Okay? But they were well advanced in age. They were older. They'd reached an age where they'd never thought they would have a child. But God chooses to answer in his own time. And then God gives them a child. And then we're talking about words that affect a life. We're talking about words that eventually affect your life. And so look at this. So God tells the angel of the Lord, says, you're going to have a child, your wife is going to be pregnant. It tells him the good news. And then John Zechariah says, remember, I'm old. Remember, hello, have you forgotten I'm old? And he says to the angel, wait. Let's get this right straight. For this plan of God to be successful, to come into fruition, we can't have you speaking bad about what God is doing. Because then remember the principle of 1 Peter 3 verse 10. When you start speaking bad about things that God is doing, you're going to make your days be dark and life is not going to be fruitful. So for the grace of God to be active in your life, Zechariah, I'm going to make sure that I devise a plan. God is going to devise a plan to circumvent your speaking from design, from destroying what God is building. And most of the time our speaking is not right. Our speaking is not the way God wants us to speak. We speak negatively. No wonder then Joshua, in the book of Joshua chapter 6, when the children of Israel, I mean, they had marched for 40 years in the wilderness, and they were coming close to coming into Jericho and taking over Jericho. And that's at the point of the final victory. Final victory. They could have messed it up. And Joshua said, you know what? Instead of messing it up for us, I know your guys, when you speak, you destroy the plan of God. Shut up. We're going to march. When we march once a day for 6 days, and we march seven times the seventh day, I want you guys to do me a favor. Keep your mouth shut. If you can't support what I'm doing, you would rather not speak against it. So God is using the same principle to Zechariah. And look at, listen to what he says. And I'm going to show you a principle about life. Now, if you read different translation, this is what it says. Verse number 18 of Luke chapter 1, we're going to look at, from three different translation, the response of Zechariah to the move of God through the angel telling him, you're gonna have a baby. Life, good life is about to hit your house. You bounce the kid. The kid, the very thing you have been believing God for, the very thing you've been trusting God for, that your prayer is gonna be answered. You have been praying and fasting, and God now has finally broken through and giving you an answer. He's coming through for you. He's giving everything that you need. Now that good life is about to begin, he's still lagging behind. He's still hung up on bad speaking. And let's listen to what happens and what God does. Verse 18 says, Zechariah said to the angel, how can I be sure, this is the NLT translation, how can I be sure this will happen? I am an old man now, and my wife is also well along in years. Then the angel said, listen to the angels, I'm Gabriel, and stand in the very presence of God, which means what I'm going to declare now come from God directly. I'm inspired by God to say what I'm going to say, the angel says. It was he who sent me to bring you this good news. But now, since you didn't believe what I said, you will be silent. Oh my God. You will be what? You will be silent. Because God knows evil speaking destroys his plan. Evil speaking makes life sour and life bad. So for you to have a good life, I therefore have to prevent from speaking. You will be silent. You will be smitten with silence. You will be silent and unable to speak until the child is born. Oh my God. For my words will certainly be fulfilled at the proper time. Now listen to the details of the text. It says you will be silent. You'll only speak after the child is born, for my words will be fulfilled. My words, God says my words. And I don't need your words to cancel my words in your life. So God then makes us understand that there are a lot of things he wants to do for us. There are many breakthroughs that are stacked up that have been returned and claimed to heaven because we have canceled them with our speaking. And that is why in this incident, God bypasses Zechariah, the recipient's speaking, by keeping him silent and making him unable to speak, because God knew if he allow him to speak, he will activate spiritual principles that says bad speaking cancel good life. And God says, no, I'm not going to let you speak. No, not under my watch. And I'm going to show you what would have happened. I'll show you what would have happened. Let me read another translation. It says, but the angel said, I am Gabriel, the sentinel of God, sent especially to bring you these glad tidings. But because you won't believe me, you'll be unable to say a word until the day your son's birth. Every word I've spoken to you will come true on time, God's time. Every word. It's a competition of words. It's Zechariah's negative words that God is blocking, that have the potential to cancel God's word over his life because he doesn't believe what God says. And God does something about it to say, if you want to have a good life, if I want to give Zechariah a good life, I might as well prevent him from saying the things that he's saying, because negative speaking cancels good life. Okay, in other translations, I like the Amplified translation. It says, the angel replied, verse number 19, Amplified, and said, I am Gabriel, I stand and minister in the very presence of God, and I've been sent by him to speak to you and to bring you this good news. Listen carefully. You will be continually silent and unable to speak until the day when these things take place. God says, I'll only bring back your speech after these things have taken place, after good life has come into your life. Because if I let you speak now, you will cancel everything, every plan that God says I have for you. And how many of us are guilty of that sin? That God starts to do good things, we cancel it with negative speaking. And that's why the Bible says with good life. Now, look at this very carefully. I want to take you through some thoughts I don't need to think about. Had God not cancelled, suspended Zechariah's speech, and John had not come, if he had missed the miracle of John coming at the right time, at God's appropriate time, this is what would have happened. If John had not been born, number one, there would not been a forerunner for the Lord Jesus Christ. There would not been a forerunner. Life would not have given us a forerunner in the New Testament, because his father would have cancelled the works of God. Number two, Jesus would not have had a Peter as one of his disciples. Because remember, Andrew was one of the disciples with disciples of John. When he saw Jesus, he followed Jesus, and he went to recruit his brother, and Peter came through his brother. And remember, Andrew, to begin with, he was the disciple of John. So we wouldn't have a Peter today who would have been one of the key apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who had the key to bring the Gentiles into the kingdom of God. That would never have happened if God had not suspended the words of Zechariah. Okay, and what would have happened? The pre-Jesus period would not have happened. Would not have had a man of the caliber of John. Wouldn't be knowing about discipleship, because it's John who started the discipleship that extended to Jesus. Because some of the disciples of John became the disciples of the disciples of Jesus. We would have been deprived of the truth of repentance and baptism, because it is John who began to preach about repentance and baptism, telling us that we need to be saved. One of the greatest miracles on earth, to be born again, to be saved, came through John. John introduced it. Wouldn't have had that miracle being introduced by John had God not suspended the words of Zechariah. We would not have had Peter, the first among equals. Peter came through to come to Christ. Without Peter, if we didn't have Peter, would not have known who Christ is. Because it is Peter who said, with the revelation of saying, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Without Peter, no human would have walked on the water. Wouldn't have known that as humans, we could walk on the water without Peter. And that is why Peter is the one that has taught us as humans, we can extend our faith to a point of walking on the water. The New Testament would not have seen the good days that he's seeing today. Would not have a Peter first among equals, and Peter walking into prison and knowing God had taken us out of man-made prisons. And prisons, what do? They limit your actions. When you're held up in prison, you can't extend. You can't extend your church. You can't extend your business. You can't extend everything you do, your brand. You can't extend. You are limited. You can't gain new territories. Wouldn't have known that if Peter had not gone into prison. Wouldn't have had a Peter if there was no Andrew. Wouldn't have had an Andrew if there was no John. Wouldn't have had John if God had allowed Zechariah to speak negatively. We couldn't have known a man of God in the book of Acts chapter 5 whose shadow began to heal the people. And the Bible says when Peter walked by, people were healed. And people were healed, and all of those were lame and crippled, they stood up because of the shadow of Peter. Wouldn't have had a colorful and a bright New Testament had God allowed the words of Zechariah to continue. It makes sense why the Lord said, I declare you'll be mute.
You won't be able to speak as you'll be silent. It'll stop you from speaking because I can't afford your words canceling my plan. And look at how life has turned out for the New Testament. Life has turned out well. I'm born again. You are born again. I'm a child of God because I can learn from a Peter. And the Peter came from an Andrew. Andrew came from a John. And John came from the words of God that took authority in the life of Zechariah over his own doubt, over his own unbelief. I don't know who I'm preaching to. And God says, I would have done more for your life. Your life would have turned out a miracle and would have turned out with great things happening. I would have given you everything you ever wanted if had you watched your tongue. And God is calling us today to watch our tongue, to make sure the things that we say are the things of the kingdom of God, are the things of the word of God. And I'm going to ask God to forgive us where we did not line up with his will. We did not say the things he had us to say. We said things out of our doubt, out of our negativity, out of our problems. We pointed out God the obvious while he was pointing out to us the miraculous. I pray to God that today you change your mind. You ask God to put a guard over your mouth. You change how you speak. Good life is here. It's about to hit your shores. If you just make sure you watch your words, watch your mouth, and ask God to put a guard over your mouth in the name of Jesus. I pray that God give you the miracle. It would come to your children. For too long, God has been trying to bring the things you've been praying for. But when God sent his angels to deliver the miracle to your doorstep, when God sent his angel to deliver the answer of the things you've been fasting and praying about, but God has been unable to effect it in your life because just at the opening of your mouth, at the use of your words, at the pronouncement of your tongue, it has canceled the works of God. It has done away with the plan of God. And God says, for how long I will send things and they'll go back to heaven unclaimed, and miracles sent and they say returned to the sender. The miracles of blessing, the cars I've sent, the homes I've sent, they've returned unclaimed. But now today, you don't be like Zechariah. You don't speak negatively in the midst of the presence of God. You must know how to judge the times when God manifests himself. You've got to receive in the spirit everything he says is yours. Agree with him. One definition of the word confession, it means to agree with God. Agree with what? With God. That the blessing is mine. That is the timing for it. Haven't you heard from the text? And God said, and the angel said to Zechariah, it will happen in its proper time. And God has sent me to tell you, this is the proper time of heaven to deliver the miracle. It doesn't matter how long it took. It doesn't matter how long you waited for it. But God said, it's my time. It's my season. Good life is happening to you. You've got to give God praise because not that he can't answer, but you can't receive of what he's doing in the name of Jesus.
You will never settle for less. We know there's more that's found in you. We will never settle.
Yeah.
Wow, praise the Lord. If you've been listening to our telecast, maybe you've never given your life to Jesus. You don't know Him as Lord and Savior. It's a time now to receive Him. But it's also a time for many people to start checking your mouth, to making sure your words line up with God's words. Your tongue can spoil your life. That's why God kept Zechariah silent. If you need to accept Jesus, may you pray this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Save me. Wash me clean in your blood. Make me your child. And thank you for renewing me by the Holy Spirit and making me brand new. I receive my salvation now. Father, pray for all those that pray the prayer, that the confirmation of salvation will come upon them and they will be blessed and they will become your child. Continue to read your Bible. We love you. We shall close the service with a song. Love you. See you next time in Jesus' name.
Hey, we will never settle for less. We will never settle for less.
Thank you for listening to the Word of God. Don't forget to share with friends and tell them it will always remain online on our Facebook and social media platforms. The Word of God, when it's preached, be doers of the Word. And don't forget, we do our part, we ask you to do your part. Our bank details will be on the screen, asking you to support us because we're even going bigger and wider and we are on TBN now. Remember, our services on Thursday, in-person service. Now we have Wednesdays and Thursdays. We invite you to come, present yourself to hear the Word of God speaking into your life. Thus saith the Lord. We love you. God bless you.